And either way, I have to leave at 8:30, but there's another meeting coming in at 8:45, so maybe we can make this, try to close this at 8:30 then, if that's... So good morning and welcome back after everyone's summer, and like I said, I'm sure everyone's refreshed after last night's game and feeling chipper and... So to, let's see, first thing we've got is if anyone remembers the June 2nd meeting, I would entertain a motion to...
So moved.
Okay, second.
I'll second.
Okay. So next up is the McIntyre Building.
That's going to be Acting City Manager Nancy Coburn-Buff.
Nancy.
Yes, hello, everyone.
Good morning.
Everybody met Nancy?
Good morning. I think I've met everyone here, yeah.
Oh.
Wait, before we do that.
Before we do that, that's why I was looking for Alan's name here. Want to introduce Alan Gold, Alan's newest member, comes to us with a deep background in marketing and hopefully can help us with messaging. And maybe, Alan, you can take a minute, tell us about yourself a little bit.
Sure. As Everett said, I've career marketing and strategy. Been here for 7 years, coming up to visit for probably twice that. My wife and I settled into the South End. By day, I do strategy and marketing consulting these days, and I currently sit on ArtSpeak, the board as well. I'm the president of the board of the Seacoast Rep, and I do some work with the Chamber of Commerce. I'm sorry, the Chamber Collaborative. Now, and very much looking forward to helping here how I can.
Thanks, and Alan, I don't know if it's actually replaces, but John Bozen had to leave the board. We're really sorry to see John leave. John's official residence was Rye, so he had to resign from the board. As it turns out, he's now sold that house. I'm not quite sure where he's moving to. At one point, he told me it might have been Hampton, so I don't know. But in any event, we wish John well, and hopefully we'll see him back here. I know he had some surgery yesterday, but maybe he'll just get a shoulder done. So maybe he'll stop back in here in the near future. So again, welcome, Alan. Glad to have you. And Alan can really help us with messaging. We talked a great deal yesterday about how sometimes the city doesn't always get out, you know, the right message despite the, you know, all our best intents and interest to do the right thing. So with that, we'll turn it over to Nancy.
It's been a fairly busy summer, actually, with the McIntyre property. The city continues to try and acquire that from the federal government. And tomorrow, the city council actually is meeting four of the five developer teams that continue to be interested in the site. So we had seven originally reply to the request for qualifications that was earlier in the summertime. Since then, two have pulled out for a variety of their own reasons, you know, being too busy, et cetera, et cetera. We've got five left, and four will be coming tomorrow to meet the council.
Nancy, is that an open public
meeting? It is an open public meeting, yes. So that's at the Levinson Room. It's from 9 to 1 o'clock tomorrow. In the meantime, those four are actually Wind Development, Leggett McCall, Redgate plus Kane Companies, and two international group with Ocean Properties.
Is the fifth going to come at any point?
The fifth is unable to attend tomorrow. They have an out-of-town commitment that was pretty well committed before we announced that date. So I don't think. The fifth is 100 Market and Mike Simchek. So he just was not able to make tomorrow.
And it will be recorded. Right.
And it will be recorded. And the thought behind tomorrow is that we've received the qualifications packages from each of the teams, but there's no familiarity with them. So we have put out the RFP already to these teams that is due at the beginning of November. But this provides the council with an opportunity to actually become more familiar with who these people are in advance of receiving their proposals in November, so it wouldn't be, you know, such a shock to kind of get all that information at once. And they have been asked to generally introduce themselves, and most of them are bringing their architectural team as well, and answer a couple of questions, which is, you know, point to a project that they've done in the past that involves a public-private partnership like we're contemplating on the McIntyre site, and what makes them interested in the McIntyre site to begin with. In the meantime, the city behind the scenes has been meeting with the federal government and the state historic preservation office to try and, you know, map out the future with regard to historic preservation covenants that will be placed on the building as soon as it's transferred, and what are the qualities of the building that we hope to see preserved into the future through regulation. The city has also been interviewing commercial real estate advisors to participate on the project, as well as special legal counsel. So we anticipate that the legal document drafting at least is going to be a pretty heavy lift on this project. It is a ground lease as determined by the federal regulations. So the city will eventually be taking title to the property and then leasing it back to an interested, you know, partner. The federal government, in the form of the National Park Service, has the authority to review and approve all of the leasing documents, including the primary ground lease and any subtenant lease that is effectuated on the property.
For what interval?
Forever.
Okay.
And I think that I may have mentioned this the last time I was here before the committee, but there are a couple of things that are unique about the historic monument program in particular. One is that the monument itself is being considered the McIntyre building and site. So that is to have a preservation covenant attached to the deed in perpetuity, in effect, such that any changes that are made to the property will be reviewed into the future by National Park Service and the State Historic Preservation Office. But more uniquely and exciting, I think, for the city's perspective, is that whoever our partner is limited by federal regulation to a reasonable profit in partnering with us, and anything beyond what we determine is a reasonable profit will come back to the city for expenditure on historic preservation or open space and park purposes. So the city will be setting up a special revenue account where I think annually those, whatever the excess profit is from the development, will be deposited into that account to then be expended in accordance with those regulations. Yeah.
So questions?
Just as a quick comment, we did have one work session before this where we, the city council, had time to talk to sort of the expert that we had hired on contract to guide us through this process. And I don't remember the woman's name.
Yeah, Lisa McCann.
Lisa, she was great. She had been sitting on the other side of the table literally for like 20 plus years or something.
Yes, yeah.
So she knew all of the ins and outs, what the real reasonable expectations of what you can do and not do with each little facet of the property, which gave us, I think, a real clear view of what we can focus on and what's not going to be valuable in our, for our time to focus on. And that's also been recorded. And mm-hmm. So if you wanted to go watch that, the period of time where she's actually talking about this is relatively short, but I think it would give you some insight if you were interested in knowing more about the details of the property. The quick summary, if you didn't quite catch it, is the main building itself is protected. Right? You're not adding to that or taking away. There's some features to the front and some certain areas that are going to be protected. The post office building envelope itself would probably be protected, but not necessarily everything inside because it had already been changed. It may be possible to add up a little bit on top of that in a smaller venue, maybe it's a rooftop restaurant, or you know, you can do all kinds of interesting things, and that's why we're having the developers in. But otherwise, that's fairly scoped as is, and it's really the parking lot behind it, right, that we could talk about, and the view sheds and all the other things that actually are also a consideration. It's not just, you know, what's in the zoning, but also part of that historic preservation is you can't just block it from view and things like that. So there's lots of facets and angles, and it's really great we have that consultant on hand.
Yeah.
See, is the concept of reasonable profit codified, or is that negotiated?
It's negotiated. The Park Service provides some background with regard to all the projects they've done across the country, but it's actually not in any regulation.
I'm sure we'll be hearing a lot more about this.
Yeah, and you can follow the project website, too. That is available under the planning department on our website, so you can reach it and see essentially everything that's been done. You know, you can read the RFP, all of the development qualification packages, et cetera. So.
Nancy, do you have a timeline on the actual acquisition of the property?
Yeah, that's a good question. So the GSA has been, originally they were targeting to be out of the building by October of 2018. And that time frame has lagged a little bit. They're now projecting December of 2018. So once we find a partner, apply to the program, have the application approved, then the GSA has to do their own thing with regard to their own disposition process.
Bob?
Are there similar projects in around the country that we could look at and
Yeah.
How they turned out and
yeah.
models. Or?
There are similar projects. One very good project to look at is the Grove in Asheville, North Carolina. That's approximately, I think, it might be a little bit bigger than our project.
It looks the exact same.
Yeah. the other projects that we actually have access to all of the documents for, one's in Wausau, Wisconsin. It was a federal building that was converted into residential development. there's one in Lakeland, Florida, that was a federal building taken over by the county that is essentially released to for office space. So it was office space. It continues to be office space, only managed by the county. I don't have the name, but there's a former World War II film factory in Brooklyn. That also was the subject of this program. It's a little bit, in Lisa's opinion, it's a little bit less of a good example to compare to this, but it's a very high profile one.
Nancy, do you see the city asking the EDC to take some role in this?
I think that we have been communicating, you know, through Nancy, really, a message that whatever use that is activated on the site be beneficial to the city's overall, you know, economic development for the downtown. So, and I'm happy to hear anything more about what the EDC would, you know, envision for that site.
Ron, a question: can the unimproved land adjacent to the building part of the property, can that be developed, or is that?
It can be. It can be. It's all subject to review and approval. Yeah.
So it could be mixed use with some parking, with some
yes.
green space.
Yep.
So previous to this, we'd all had some conjecture that maybe it would be a big mixed use kind of
mm-hmm.
property and could add value to the city in a lot of different ways and facets. So that's still
yeah.
on the table. It's just
it is.
That the original building must stay in its current form.
Right. You got it.
Is there an expectation that the post office will remain where it is or move to a more convenient location?
The council has had a discussion about that, actually, and the post office would like to remain on the site. They'd like to remain exactly where they are. They would be a fully market-paying tenant to any partner that would be having the site if they were interested in keeping them there. The council has said they would like to keep the post office use retail function somewhere on the site, not necessarily exactly where it is.
Other questions? Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Looking forward to hearing more about that.
Thank you very much.
And just to remind people that it also has to go through our zoning process
right.
as well.
Yep.
So, yeah, the character zoning will apply.
Yes.
You know, first floor. Residential, all of that. And, you know, we're really looking to the partners for their creativity on what can happen there. And there's been a lot of feedback over time about what the people of the city want to see in that building through our master planning process. But there will be opportunities to weigh in mm-hmm. again, I think, during that that land use permitting process. So we'll continually update. You'll see this on our agenda, I'm sure, for the next year.
Or two or three.
Yeah. Very good. Yeah. Thank you again.
It's slightly non-conforming with the existing because of the height, correct?
It is non-conforming.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah.
Next on the agenda, Foundry Place redevelopment, municipal garage. So maybe Nancy and I could both pick this one up. As you probably know, they had the groundbreaking. Number of Councilor Sear and Councilor Spears, not here today, was there, and I think John and a lot of us, Bob, Dana.
Here's who was there.
Oh, here we are.
There's the EDC.
Here we are.
Is he at work?
Is he at work? Right.
Is he
so
at work? Yeah.
You know, I just. I think that was a great day for the city, and it was a long, long journey for us to get there. And so thank you, everyone, for your contribution to that. It was took many, many more years than we ever thought. So and I think the schedule is it's pretty short now. It's done. It's almost I think Dave Allen said it's like putting up a Lego set that it's going to be, or one of the builders said that. So it's going to be maybe a year.
About a year from now is what they're shooting for. At least that's what Dave Allen said at the groundbreaking. He liked being at the groundbreaking, but he would much rather be at the ribbon cutting, which he anticipates being in about a year. So I think it's really exciting that after all these trials and tribulations to find a site downtown, it's actually going to happen, and it will allow us to do some different things with our downtown land use now that we have capacity. So
just one quick comment for those that might drive down Deer Street and kind of peek in there. We've all seen it on the maps where the garage is, but I think visually you probably would be hard pressed to guess it's that far back.
Mm-hmm.
The parking garage is actually so if you drive through, there's the green wall for the construction, and it's a good 15 feet or more behind that is where the actual walls of the start. So that green wall kind of represents that common area.
The civic space,
right? So just think about that when you're driving through, because it's not as far forward as a lot of people, I think, would imagine.
Yeah, that's right. It's interesting how deep, like you said, it goes in that lot, and you're all the way behind the former JSA. I'm trying to think. The Heinemann building goes all the way back there. So, right, it's quite a sight.
But Dave Allen did mention at the groundbreaking that he did a leisurely walk to Market Square. It took him 7 minutes from the garage. So, and it's an interesting perspective when you put yourself where the garage is, and then you look at the cityscape and you see, you know, you're just a stone's throw from 51 Islington Street and Discover Portsmouth. And
yeah, not everybody is going to walk to Market Square.
Right. Yeah. I think the North End is going to be.
There are other places in the city.
Another destination for sure.
From that garage.
They do?
I think so.
Oh, all right. Good to know.
And, you know, we have so much going and activating up in the West End and on the Islington Corridor along the West End, you know, right here, which has parking and or very little, and with the brewery right there and other stuff kind of all backing up there. So I think that's actually a good proximity, although we don't really think about that end.
Yeah.
For sure.
The other thing about the garage is that it does qualify for the city's ordinance for percent for art. So we're working right now with ArtSpeak. They are administrating that ordinance, and there is a draft RFP that will be going out shortly, and there'll be an optional site walk for the artists, and that will be a really interesting element to this new structure in the downtown. So.
Okay, very good. Business retention expansion. Nancy has the final report.
Yeah, I have the final report, but I'm not handing it out to you yet because we're hoping that our leadership team can meet and go over that report before we go over it as a commission and maybe put together a draft schedule for rollout of the results. I will hand out, though, just we did look at the draft report, and Everett and Alan and I talked about this yesterday in his orientation. There's a few items that were just obvious low-hanging fruit that the EDC could consider in our work plan for 2018, and I'll hand this out. Oh, you got one?
Okay, yeah.
We can quickly go over that. So these are just our notes from our leadership team meeting this summer. And one of the first things was just what's going to be our strategy to raise awareness and the messaging that's going to come from this report and the findings. And some suggestions that came up during our discussions were emailing the findings and potential actions out to the task force that took the time to interview the businesses, the city council, and the businesses that were actually the participants in the survey. Using all avenues of media, press release, city website, and posting the report in that action, and what we come up with our action list online. And in addition to that, I've talked with Acting City Manager and City Manager John Bohanko about having some type of forum, perhaps at the Levinson Room. One of the interesting things was when it comes to foreign trade and opportunities for some of our local businesses that already do foreign trade, or those that might be at a point in their growth, their market growth, to consider foreign trade. And many of them had not heard about or ever had any involvement with the International Trade Resource Center, which is a state agency that is pretty remarkable, one of the best, I think, here in New England. And you know, programs through the Export-Import Bank, Small Business Development Center. So, you know, a pretty simple thing that we could do for those businesses that are ripe for this type of thing is, you know, pull a forum together with all the resources that are available, and help some growth there. And that would be a great avenue for growing and retaining those companies here in Portsmouth. And then there's always the workforce development conundrum and, you know, what those resources and opportunities are. You know, we learned how our businesses are seeking employees. It's a lot of things. It's, you know, it's the internet, it's word of mouth, it's advertising, it's trade journals, it's that type of thing. But there's other avenues that I think that we could also bring to the fore for them that, that they may not have considered. So again, getting out there, raising awareness of what these resources are that we have here in the state and in the region to help them find the qualified workforce that they're looking for. And it was interesting also talking to some of the businesses about, especially the ones out at Pease, where they have a commuting workforce that doesn't necessarily live in town. They may drive 20 to 40 minutes to get here, and then they turn around and then they leave. And they were asking about what are the recreational opportunities, what can they do for that workforce to make that employment environment better. And it's out there, that information's out there, but I think we could maybe do a brochure or you know, do something to a presentation to the Tenants Association at Pease to make people aware of what's going on, what the city does provide that might improve the quality of work for the workforce for some of our companies here. The other thing that we learned is that peer networks and roundtables, peer-to-peer networks and discussions were something that was desired by some of the upper management that we interviewed. So we are starting to work with the chamber on that already. Actually, we're going to roll out a pilot manufacturing roundtable. Probably the first one will be in November with a group of maybe 20 manufacturers here in Portsmouth, and kind of actually fashioned after the Cyborg roundtables that David Choate chairs, where you know, we get these folks in the group and they can talk about what their needs and wants are and maybe hammer out some solutions or some opportunities that we could help with the manufacturing trades here in Portsmouth. And then possibly move down the line for the different sectors. And then just a campaign to advertise local and regional resources for business plan development. We found that, and you know, I thought, kind of a low number of the businesses had a business plan. That might not be shocking to you bankers on the commission, but and especially some of the smaller ones. And remember, we did interview a whole range of companies, so there's a lot of resources here in the Seacoast for that. So again, that was a kind of a no-brainer to do that.
Sarah?
So one thing I think is missing here is outreach with other commissions and committees in the city around areas that impact businesses.
Great.
Being in Portsmouth, like housing, I think there's a big house-shaped hole here in these recommendations. So that came up consistently in the survey results, if I recall. So if there's anything we can do to provide information to other committees that this is a serious issue for businesses, we should mine that and work with our fellow constituents here.
Great, thanks. And again, this is just the first blush.
Yep.
So we'll be getting that report out to you and looking forward to your comments on it. Anything else? Any other suggestions from those of you that interviewed? Or?
Up, Josh.
Okay. That sums it up.
Yeah. So we'll get together as a leadership team and,
yep.
and come up with a strategy for rollout.
Vaughn Worth, Bridge Revitalization. So I'm trying to think if I'm...
That's you.
Just me, I guess. So we've met several times. I can't remember if we spoke about it at the last meeting. The mayor was asked, and the mayor put together this commission. Members, I think it's the head of the HDC, planning, EDC, and a couple of city citizens to sit on this commission to kind of look at what the vision is for the Bridge Street lot, the Worth lot, and the Vaughn Mall, all in light of the fact that we're going to have this new garage within a year. So we've done site walks, we've had meetings, we've had public comment met, we've reviewed comments online from just the general public at large. And it's been interesting, you know, all the way from, you know, we should have green space everywhere to we should preserve all the parking. Kind of know where our view kind of sits on that. So, but I think there's been some really interesting conversations around, at a minimum to kind of beautify, especially a lot of focus on the bridge lot, given that it's really kind of an oasis of parking there. It's pretty, you know, a lot of blight there. It's really, you know, very unappealing. And so I think at a minimum we're going to see something change there in the future, and maybe it's part pocket park and part parking, and so I think we're going to see some new development. I think also I should be mindful to say that a lot of things we talked about there, it's a long-term view. We're going to be a lot of years out before we can, you know, digest what the impact of this new garage is. You know, I think at the same time there was some sense amongst the committee that if they could take a snapshot of, you know, 5+ years down the road, that at least some of the people said we would have a parking garage at Worth, maybe somewhat smaller than was originally conceived, and that maybe there would be some kind of a park at Bridge Street, and that Vaughn needed to have a facelift. So but it's a continuing discussion and input from the community. I could share that at least initially, one of the couple thoughts around Bridge Street, which were interesting, is that, you know, the turn areas, the backup areas are extra wide in that lot. So you could narrow the lot, not lose any spaces, potentially not close, but or partially close Bridge Street to one-way traffic. And there's parking on one side of the street there, and it's two-way. So would you consider eliminating the one side of the parking, making it one-way, expanding it, and maybe making, you know, a park the length of, you know, that block, at the same time not losing the parking? That might not, you know, that sounded like something that was reasonable to a lot of people. So more to come there. It's, you know, I think we're going to have a couple of meetings with City Council or some presentations, and I don't think we're supposed to wrap up for like a year, so a lot more to come there.
And we have a consultant, correct?
We do. And I can't remember the name.
Yeah, the city's working with a consultant to assist in any conceptual ideas for the for this committee, and it's, I think it's the same group that did the Prescott Park master plan.
Yeah, that's right.
So,
Rich.
But, one area that I've found, where I've personally heard confusion and some consternation from area businesses around there, because I work right kind of right next to that whole space, is that a lot of people seem to think that you're talking about something to do next year.
Right.
Right? So can you provide any clarity? Because even 5 years sounds really short term to me.
Yeah.
What's the sense of the charge for what you're really looking for the when this would be going?
Yeah,
out?
That, you know what, Josh, that was all, we all had the same question. So I don't think it's clear yet.
Yeah.
It's just what's the long-term vision for this space? And then at the same time, as we digested that, it's, well, what can we do short term possibly? So it's a, you know, it's got a whole range.
So the idea is it might be phased, right? So
it could be phased.
There might be an intermediary parking option, but long term, like the whole idea of parking in cars that we have now is not going to be even remotely the same in 15 years, and it has nothing to do with parking garages. So that's to do with new technology, right? And we don't know how that effect's going to be, and I think that's going to change significantly our impact or even need for spaces like the kind we have over there. So I'm glad to hear that there might be some, sort of a phased approach, because I just think that we're probably going to revisit this. In 10
yeah, years. I think, and you know, there's a lot of discussion around Uber and autonomous cars and all of that. So it was really about, you know, we need to be flexible, but there needs to be some improvement relative to, you know, visually what these places look like.
In the short term, okay.
Right.
Okay.
So that's really, like I said, it's a work in progress and more to share later.
Anything else on that?
Nope, I guess not.
So next thing on the agenda is during the summer, we did get the data back from our go-to real estate advisory group, Colliers, on the first quarter results for the office and the industrial trends. I don't know if you want to recognize David, but
sure, he'll be recognized at public comment.
Right. So I'm just giving you this as a snapshot and an update of where we are in the Seacoast submarket. And you'll recall when you look at this data, this is, you know, properties that are non-medical offices in excess of 10,000 square feet. So a lot of our downtown, as you recall, is spaces that are less than 10,000 square feet. So in Portsmouth, you can see almost 4 million total in square footage of office space. And
that's the Portsmouth submarket.
Yeah, right, the submarket, the region around us. Yeah, so read the, yeah, you can read the small print. And I think that the vacancy rate, you know, there's just been, continues to be positive absorption. Agree with that, David.
Any comment, David, for the comment?
Well, the comment's the one that we all have, and Bob can back me up on this. We need industrial space. And we basically are stymieing growth because industrial vacancy is basically zero. And it might be 1 or 2%, but effectively it's zero. So companies that want to expand or locate here can't. Even the Dover Rochester area is experiencing the same lack of. And the other problem we've had, as you know, and it's not a problem that's going to be solved anytime soon, is the buildings that were built and when they become available have a fairly low ceiling height. So people are looking for 20 to 30 foot clear, which is the norm now. And the reason for all that is you can't afford to build a building. You know, if a developer comes along, you know, John Pratt was a developer and he wanted to put up a building on spec, he's going to have to get $10 to $12 minimum per square foot, and the company can't pay that. So it's a vicious cycle.
Yeah, and our rates reflect the supply and demand. You know, we have the highest asking rate in the Seacoast submarket, you know, almost $10 a square foot triple net for industrial. And similarly for office space.
Yeah, the office demand is less prevalent, in my opinion, than the industrial demand right now. There's still enough for office space or ability to build new office space, especially fees, to absorb any really, you know, and they have the ability to pay more rent. So, I mean, you know, you can go from, you know, 18 to 25 and not lose the whole market.
Ron?
Yeah, I'm wondering if industrial development is good for Portsmouth. You know, with businesses moving away from labor intensity, everything's capital intensive. I'm wondering if really the higher level jobs are what we're really trying to attract. Do we need more industrial space?
Yes, you do. Advanced manufacturing is huge.
Precision manufacturing.
Medical industry stuff. Remember you went on the NovaCure
right.
Thing, but then there's this new company that just announced that they're going to eventually try to set up a facility somewhere around here. So it's going to be a different type of manufacturing. But the other thing is warehousing and distribution. So I think what you're going to start to see across the country, and I don't know if there'll be an opportunity here, for example, in the Foxborough Mall, for example, but where you're going to see a lot of these retail malls becoming warehousing and distribution centers, fulfillment centers. I mean, Amazon is basically going to take over the world, so you know, it wouldn't be surprising to see a fulfillment center somewhere, what used to be a mall.
That's why our zoning should be flexible. You know, we should at least try and prepare for changing business environment like that, so we're not as rigid in our requirements, so people don't have to come in for a variance to do something like put a warehouse in Kmart, you know, something like that. So we might want to think about that going forward.
So some of you, just an interesting anecdote, some of you may have seen that Amazon put out that they're looking for their second headquarters. Yesterday, and no, residents have encouraged us to respond to the RFP, but if you look at the RFP, they're looking to employ 50,000 people in a population base of, you know, at least a million or more, and their first building they want to be 500,000 square feet, and the build out in 2027 to be 8 million, which, you know, if you look at all of the Portsmouth industrial and submarket industrial and office, I think it totals something like 16 million everything all in. So it would be wonderful to have a campus for Amazon somewhere in New Hampshire.
It's as capricious as the governor going around saying, well, we could have gotten GE if I had been governor.
Right.
You're not going to get them out of
ours. Right. But that's the type of thing that, you know, cities are competing for, and those are obviously, it's a good company, it's good jobs, but we can't meet those needs. But, you know, certainly if we thought we could, or if we could collaborate to do it.
But there are other things that Amazon's looking for that the infrastructure that we don't have around public transportation,
right.
You know, proximity to international airports. So it's a bit of a pipe dream for Portsmouth
right.
to be here, but those types of characteristics right. are important for businesses.
Right. They want right on-site rail, intermodal, right to the
yep.
campus. Seattle has 33 buildings. That's what they would like, something like that in their second headquarters. So
yeah, we're much better off growing businesses organically. We've talked about that.
Mm-hmm.
Talked about it here in the past, facilitating their ability to grow here and not have to move somewhere else or put a second facility somewhere else.
Which is why we did the business retention expansion
program.
And, you know, it's kind of fun to talk about the Amazon thing, but clearly it wouldn't happen here in New Hampshire. There's been a lot of talk even in the Boston market, and Scott Kirstner did a really great article. He's about the Boston market and how it wouldn't even happen there.
Right.
We're just
right.
too expensive. New England's too expensive. And would the the speed at which they want to build these buildings simply wouldn't happen anywhere in New England, like in sort of our environment, certainly not around Boston. You know, you could theoretically have it somewhere there, and it would impact us, right? And for those people that would want those jobs, it could be meaningful impact, but it's not likely to be anywhere near here.
Ron?
One infrastructure thing that would be, I think, important to the development of businesses is if we ever got an airline that flew to a hub. Mm-hmm. Because right now, your only way to transport business personnel is Boston or Portland, primarily Boston. But if you had an airline that was connected to a hub, then that opens up business travel internationally, basically. So that's probably the one thing that could have the most positive impact on professional jobs in this area. Because now, when they're doing a business trip, you can fly right out of Portsmouth into Atlanta or another hub. And that's something that I think they're looking at right now. They have a consultant at the PEACE here to look at that.
We have
right?
Manchester.
Yeah. We do have Manchester.
Sort of like parking. We get yeah. sort of spoiled.
Yeah.
Because there's an airport here. Yeah. It'd be great if we could drive 5 minutes and get on a plane.
Exactly.
But going to Manchester is pretty easy. You know, if you, as you know, flying into other areas of the country, it's sometimes very difficult to
yeah.
get from where you are to get to the airport. And an hour isn't
yeah.
out of the question.
The trade-off for me when I travel, do business travel, is with Boston you have unlimited options. So Manchester, you're more limited to Southwest, so you don't have as many options. So I just figure, heck,
Boston's
it's an extra
close.
20 minutes to drive to Boston. I have C&J, which makes
right.
it more convenient. So I don't think...
Right, so getting outside of the airport thing, I think
yeah.
what really enables Portsmouth to make that flexibility is having... you know, transport options like C&J, and
right.
I think that's probably the more important thing for us to be continuing to
mm-hmm.
try to support.
Yep.
Okay, and so since we're just kind of wrapping up on that, anything else, David, in the real estate report you want to share?
I have a few other items.
For public comment? Okay. So I guess we'll just pass over to Nancy for House Bill 369.
This is just something I wanted to put on your radar. You may have read about it in Business New Hampshire Magazine and a couple of other media outlets, but recently the legislature passed a bill that allows statewide cities to take advantage of to offer tax break property tax break incentives to businesses, which we have not been able to do in the past. This was an incentive that was unique to Coos County because the state was working to try to attract businesses to the North Country. And, you know, there's some, I just want you to know this, because there's some cities in the seacoast like Dover that are it's enabling legislation that allows communities to offer these tax breaks for up to 50% for 10 years. And so it's going to be interesting to see what that does to the landscape of business attraction and retention. Once you do this, you have to keep it in place for 5 years, this legislation. And it doesn't have to be the full amount. It's a sliding scale. You can negotiate. But if people want, I can get you more information on that. Haven't really had an opportunity to discuss it with, you know, I've had a really brief discussion with Nancy Kohberg-Puff, obviously city managers on sabbatical, so I don't know if there would be the political will to do that given the current tax environment here in Portsmouth, but it's there, and all that's important right now is that other communities around here have that opportunity to have that legislation in their community, vote to use this tool, if you will, and whether it puts, you know, one city at a disadvantage to another will you know, remain to be seen, just given the unique nature of our tax structure here in New Hampshire for getting the services that we need, you know, using this. So that's there. We can talk about it more if some of you feel really strongly about it. I'd like to hear what your thoughts are on it. So.
Josh.
So I, you know, I certainly don't speak for the whole council, but I would suspect the political will to do something like that would be somewhere around 0%. and that's given the recent assessments and
the shift from commercial to residential. And, you know, the perception, which, you know, is fairly accurate, if you look at the actual tax impact, is, you know, taxes were actually just reduced. Now, the tax potential was reduced for a number of commercial properties already. So that would be, you know, that any discount we would offer to businesses would be borne and redistributed to anybody else. And mm-hmm. I just can't imagine that politically that there would be a whole lot of interest in that. And you know, anything that would get brought up for that would likely be in the next council, I would guess. I mean, depending on mm-hmm. how you would track that. But, you know, personally, I think a wait-and-see approach for that and seeing how it impacts other cities would probably be...
how it plays out, yeah. But I just felt that as commissioners, it's something you should be aware mm-hmm. of, because there's sure. not a lot of, you know, incentive tools in the state, and we'll see how it plays out.
Is that for only new business or new and existing?
Is it okay? We should recognize. Sure. And yeah. You might have to repeat your question, because
I'm sorry. Yeah, could you repeat the question? I'm sorry.
Is that only for new business, or is that from tracking new businesses or expanding existing?
Everything.
So someone could threaten to move out of town if you didn't cut their taxes in half.
Yeah. Well, that's what I think is interesting about doing this statewide, because it does, you know, in economic development, it's, you know, pirating companies from one city
right.
to the next is, you know, is really not ethical, but this kind of is interesting. So I just had one other thing, in case you didn't see the best companies to work for issue of Business New Hampshire came out yesterday, and three of our local companies once again made the grade. Loftware out at Pease, Medtronics, and Pax World Management. So I'll pass this around. You can take a look at it. Something again to be really proud of, that the city is, you know, location to a lot of these companies. I think last year we had 5 out of 20 on the list. So. And just, I hope everybody's looking and admiring what's happening on Market Street Gateway.
Yeah,
it's finally happening. And
years.
What a difference!
Yeah. Yeah.
You were with the chairman,
yeah,
right?
Forever.
I think that was another one of these. Yeah. Yeah, long.
The Islington Street corridor and,
yep,
you know, yep, all the corridors.
Yep. So, yeah,
finally
if you stay
starting.
Persistent and you put these in your capital plan,
right,
these improvements will happen. So,
From a counselor perspective, almost always when we get an email, it's somebody unhappy about something. And we actually had someone in praising and thanking, you know, profusely the efforts that were put into that and the results. So, good job.
I've heard the same. People have been remarked how great it looks and how it was kind of an industrial wasteland a little bit to kind of come through there, and it really...
What's the status of the park?
Yeah, I was just going to ask that.
So there's two parks involved in that plan, and they're both part of Phase 2, which is the next phase after the Sarah Long Bridge is completed. So the next construction phase of this project will be contingent on capital plan funding starting next July. And the Riverfront Park and the North Mill Pond Pocket Park are included in that. So you might see some work underway at the Riverfront Park, and that's an interesting project that UNH is doing to actually pull back that seawall that's there in anticipation of sea level rise, so that the salt marsh can be restored and absorb that rise going forward. So that may happen before we get in there to do our work, but we're in concert with them and in discussions with them on that. So.
Other questions before we turn on to public comment?
I think you may, because we're recording this, may have to come up to a mic.
Okay. Happy to come up to a mic. I've been waiting all summer. Just kidding. variety of things you said today sort of tie into some of the things I was going to say. One question I have, and no one's been able to answer this question, I've heard it's temporary, but if you look, if you're standing at the foot of Market Street looking up towards Bow Street, there's a whole bunch of these yard arms that were put off the poles. That's the most unsightly thing I've ever heard. I heard it was temporary because of the granary building. Does anybody know what that's about? It's amazing that it hasn't been covered by the paper. Maybe it will now. But if you just stand there and look, it's the most unsightly thing you've ever. It just happened one day. Eversource did it.
I'll find out.
Anyways, I throw that out there so somebody ought to figure out what's going on. I've heard that it was to get the electric away from the granary building, and once that's done, they're going to put it back. But if not, it's like taking a street that has all the electricity buried, and all of a sudden they put poles up. You talk about the incentive to keep businesses in the community, and I do agree, by the way, with you, Josh. I don't think it's a question of political will. I don't think we need to do that in Portsmouth. Other communities may need to do it, but I'll tell you the one thing that is going, it is definitely causing a problem, and it's falling on deaf ears every time I bring it, which is unfortunate that Nancy didn't stick around, is the inspection department is driving businesses out of town. It continues to happen. I had a situation yesterday. I'll just give you a very real life example. The city of the open door ought to be meeting with people and saying, okay, let me hear your project. What can we do to make it the best it can be within the codes and the regulations, not what can we do to make sure that you spend as much money as possible to try to meet codes that may or may not be relevant to the city of Portsmouth. We have a small space for lease next to Moe's, where F.A. Gray used to be, 900 square feet. The bowling alley space has a bathroom in the back. You know, it's an older building. It was renovated. It does meet a lot of the codes. So we had a prospective tenant called the plumbing inspector, who, by the way, is probably the worst of the inspectors in terms of being totally unreasonable. And he said, well, you know, a change of use, you're going to have to put in two bathrooms, and they have to be ADA. I mean, this is nonsense. And so this person's like, well, we can't afford to do that, and there's no space, so we got the owner involved, and, you know, we're probably going to get past that. But that's the first reaction. Or you're going to have to do this, and you're going to have to do that. Not what do you want to do, and how can we make it work? Another example, and I'm only saying, and I'm saying this really more to Josh on the council, because it's just falling on deaf ears with the city manager. And it's not the building inspectors, it's the sub-inspectors, the plumbing inspector, the health inspector. I mean, we all read about the nonsense with the deck for, you know, gaslight and so forth. The former Alex and Ani space is going to be a tasting room for LaBelle Winery. The health inspector is making them put in a grease trap. There's no food. It's liquor. It's liquid, right? A grease trap, which is an expense. I mean, this is all, you know, another example, Plaza 800, where the Dogland space is. A woman wants to put in a nail salon, and they're making her do this fancy ventilation system, which is fine, but they want stamped engineered drawings for the HVAC and plumbing that she's doing. Stamped engineered drawings is $10,000. This is not funny. I mean, this is the word is on the street. I've had contractors tell me we won't bid on jobs in Portsmouth anymore because the inspection department is so unreasonable. And, you know, they get away with it for one reason. People want to be here, and they just sort of suck it up and pay the money and go on. But it's a huge problem, I got to tell you. That was the one thing I think you'd be most concerned about, not worry about incentives or giveaways, is the perception is this is not a good place to do business. You know, you go to Dover, Rochester, it's like, what can we do to help you? How quickly can we get you through the process? Let's get everybody together in the same room and figure out the solution, not let's throw as many obstacles as we can. You know, it's a really bad problem. And I don't know how to, I'm not getting anybody's attention. Other people aren't getting other people's attention, Josh, so I don't know how you deal with it. But that's number one. I'd also urge this committee to have a presentation on the proposed new gateway mixed-use zoning. It does nothing to encourage workforce housing. I'm on record as in that public hearing. Unfortunately, there's only a couple of people that spoke at that hearing. But they have this notion that they're going to take these areas and create all this newfound housing in, A, properties that, even if they were available, like Kmart Plaza or the Homer Road area, would be so expensive you'd have to do above-market rate housing. It's just there's no attempt to make something that could be workforce housing. They purposely skipped over the New England Marine property and this rezoning. Isn't that convenient? That's a property that could have been workforce housing. So I just think this, you know, we have a workforce housing problem, which ties into the other discussion we're having is, even if you can attract the companies, they have two questions. Where's my workforce going to come from? And if I get a workforce, how can they afford to live here? And I can't. And I think I might have shared this example before. John Shagnon, who many of you know from Ambit Engineering, lost an engineer because the guy couldn't afford to commute from where he lives anymore to Portsmouth. So he went to work for an engineering firm closer to where he lives, somewhere north of here. That's a huge issue. I don't know how you solve it, but the zoning they're trying to enforce now is so complicated, I would defy anybody on this committee to read it and understand a single word of it. I've had lawyers tell me that, architects and engineers. It's so convoluted. It's like they're designing Celebration City in Florida from scratch, and this is what an ideal solution would be. So I don't know where that's going. And I think the final comment I had is just an observation. When you're talking about the Bridge Street lot redevelopment, I know it's a long-term solution. We had a fairly substantial company that looked at the new building that Anthony DiLorenzo is doing right there on Bridge Street. If you've been over there, you've, you know what I'm talking about. They would not commit to that space because no one could tell them that there would not be a building built on that space, which would totally block the visibility. You know, a park or parking is fine, but it's just I'm just offering input for who's ever on that committee, because at one time, as you know, that was going to be where the GSA wanted to go, or that's where the city manager wanted them to go. So again, some of these things have unintended consequences, so just as you think about the surroundings. So that's all I had, but I'm really concerned about this inspection issue, because it's just coming back every day. We're getting examples, and Bob, I don't know if you're hearing it from your end with tenants and owners.
It's an issue, and we have a reputation in the region for being very difficult to deal with. It used to be Durham, and now it's us.
And frankly, what needs to happen, Nancy, the city manager needs to sit down with the department heads and say, we're going to change our attitude. We're going to have a, you know, what can we do to help you within the rules and guidelines that we have, not what can we do to make your life miserable and have you spend whatever it costs to spend it because it's not our problem. And their attitude, they've actually said to people, I don't care what it costs. I want it done this way.
So these ideas have been brought up in the master planning process. It's actually included in the master plan about streamlining our permitting process. I guess I don't want to speak for city manager, acting city manager here, but it has not fallen on deaf ears. But I also remind people that Portsmouth is not Dover and it's not Rochester, and we have more restaurants here than those combined. And you know, we just saw the consequence of not meeting code with what happened, you know, with some fires that we've had in the city. And I think we need to take, you know, we take the codes very seriously. So I don't, you know, and that's their job, is to enforce these codes. You know, whether there's a discussion about how we work with developers, you know, that's a discussion that we can have. But I think to just say that the codes may or may not be relevant is not fair. And so I don't, you know, I
well,
I,
it's
I'm
it's
here,
it's
we're
it's
comments,
what is fair, Nancy, is the way the message is delivered, and frankly, there are codes, frankly, that are not required, that you know they're trying to enforce.
And thank you.
And you can't say that because we had a fire at State Street that all the buildings should be sprinkled in Portsmouth now, which is what they'd love to do, of course. I'm just telling you, you'd have to be living this every day.
Yeah.
And maybe you need to get some people in here that are willing to speak on the record about their personal experiences, because it's just all it's doing is driving up the cost of the project for everybody, which is driving up the prices they have to charge the consumer, which is driving up the prices that the landlord has to charge the tenant. I mean, it's just a vicious cycle. But it's all about perception, and you know, there's a way to deliver the message, and so people say, yeah, I understand, because there are waivers that can be granted, but they don't, you have to hire an architect, basically, or a lawyer to go with you to go through the process.
So why don't I send this message to the acting city manager and see if I can, you know, if we can have a discussion about that.
Yeah. So I just, you know.
So David, just really quickly, you're not the only one discussing that, and there are right. City councilors that have been discussing it. So it's,
yeah, well,
it's in the discussions.
In the meantime, though, it continues to persist. And I think, you know, frankly, it's as simple as saying we have to have an attitude adjustment. with some of these people, you know? I got to tell you, I've just, every day it's coming up. And again, it's not, Nancy, that the people are trying to get around the codes. It's...
Yep. Point taken.
Are there two or three alternatives to accomplish the same goal? Okay. Anyway, I don't mean to belabor that, but it's really a huge, huge problem. So thank you very much. I've had my dispute.
Okay.
It sounds like he's talking about the culture.
Right.
Yep.
It's not so much the
I think
the
we can talk about this
yeah.
at a different time.
Okay.
So. I move that we adjourn.
Yeah. I didn't know if, did you want to speak?
Myself.
Yeah. Come on up.
I think I've been in the room with most of you before, but I'm Karen Marsloff. I'm with Seacoast Local, which is a group of businesses and citizens across the whole Seacoast that are interested in generally economic development for the local economy, locally owned independent businesses, and specifically with interest toward an economy that's more local, green, and fair. So I'm just here to catch up with where Portsmouth Economic Development Commission is focusing their interest and attention, and it's a great conversation this morning. It's good to be here. Keep talking.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Karen, thank you for participating in the business retention.
Yeah, it's great
project.
To hear.
I think that's going to have it's going to be important for your organization as well.
Yeah, I think we can keep talking about the forums and how we can help with that too.
That'd be helpful.
Great.
Thanks. Vice Chair.
Well, we have a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Thank you.
All in favor?
Right.
Hey.
So we'll be meeting here next month. We're going to have the Small Business Development Center give their report on the work that they've been doing with companies here in Portsmouth.
Probably in Warren.
Warren.
Hey, absolutely. Yeah, good luck tomorrow.
All right.
Your tents are looking nice. I was out there earlier this week.